This is going to be a very interesting panel, at least my focus on this identity issue. So it is identity representations in literature. And since we are pressed for time, I'm not going to say anything before introducing the panelists. I was told that keep the time for 15 minutes, be very strict, and we have only time for two questions. And also, if you need any, I don't believe it'll be need for it, but just in case you needed a translation into English, like if somebody asked a question in Armenian or in Turkish, it'll be on channel 4, not 2. Okay, so we start with the first panelist, Murat Cankara. And for the sake of time, I've asked all my panelists to cut down their bios, so very short bio for each one of them. His PhD, Murat Cankara's PhD research, focused on the novels written by Ottoman Armenians in the Turkish language using the Armenian script between 1850 and 1870. He is currently a member of the Faculty of Social Sciences and Humanities at the Social Science University of Ankara. And his topic, Between Us and Them, A Testimony in the Other's Language.
Thank you. This works, I guess. Thank you, everybody who made this possible. This was supposed to be... No, there is nothing. So anyway, I prepared a fancy prezi presentation. Okay, but the laptop didn't like it, so we had to change it to a clumsy PDF. Sorry for that. You'll see unnecessary things, but I hope it'll be sufficient just for you to follow. The inspiration behind this draft paper is a hitherto unexplored testimony in Armeno-Turkish, that is, Turkish language written in Armenian letters, by a Catholic Armenian from Ankara, Simon Arakelyan, namely 1915 Ankara incident and my memoirs of exile, 1915 vukuatı ve menfilik hatıralarım. This is the map I'll follow. I know it's a bit complicated, but it's so simple. It's so simple. I thank Robert Koptaş for introducing the text to me. I'm very grateful. Now, while I was preparing the book for publication by Aras Publishing House, I was A, transliterating the text from Armenian letters into Latin. B, translating the text I transliterated from Turkish into Turkish so that readers could understand it today. The infamous sadeleştirme, simplification things, a nightmare. C, trying to write a meaningful preface. D, witnessing extreme cruelty and unbearable suffering exactly a century later and right on the same spot. I live in Ankara, by the way. So I began digging into secondary literature. On the one hand, I was reading Primo Levi, Zabel Yeseyan, and on the other, Mark Nishanyon, Krikor Bledyan, and many others. I was struck by the plurality of languages in Levi's work, where verbal confusion was a fundamental component of the life in the camp. A world of orders and threats in misunderstood languages. A Tower of Babel, where a rubber truncheon was called der Dolmetscher, the interpreter. So you have to understand what's going on to survive. There was a sharp contrast between Levi's multilingual camp and the route to Der Zor, where the perpetrator and the victim spoke, or at least understood, more or less the same language, that is, Turkish. So the question, if I may, what is the difference between a multilingual and monolingual genocide, if it makes any sense? So I decided that language deserves more critical attention in my research, and after reading more Armenian testimonies, I stumbled upon a basic fact. Maybe this was my ignorance. I thought, oh, something wrong. There is something wrong here. They had all reached us through a series of translations. Zabel Yesayan had suffered agonies while bringing together the testimonies in Armenian and Turkish, all the survivors after the massacres in Adana in 1909. Mahram Altunyan's testimony, written in a 34-page notebook in Turkish with Armenian letters, was unearthed only through a translation into French. Aram Andonian had written, sorry, this Andonian, I skipped the picture. Aram Andonian had written in Armenian, but with the intention of getting the English and French translations published first. Captain Sarkis Torosyan told his story in Armenian to an Armenian lady who knew English and put it into draft. It is still uncertain whether the printed book is based on this draft or a second one that was edited years later by the author himself. Rafael Janikyan wrote his memoirs in Armenian, translated it into Italian himself, and then the text was edited by Pietro Küçükyan before it was published for the first time. Examples abound. That is, in the Armenian case, the miscommunication was not between the perpetrator and the victim, but rather between textual representation and its later transmissions, where things tend to fall between the cracks and get lost in translation more easily because the source and the target languages seem to be identical. In other words, Levy depicted a hell on earth where the act of translating from one language to the other, understanding a word or pronouncing it in a certain way, was literally a matter of life and death. Whereas in my case, words caused problems in texts rather than in the scenes of crime. I realized that I could even dedicate a whole article to the politics of italicization in Yeseans in the ruins, Averagnorim Mech. A fancy article, The Politics of Italicization in Zabel Yesean. Wonderful topic, because the italicized Turkish words do not match in the first edition, in the Aras edition and the Turkish edition, which means what is Turkish and what is not changed over time. Anyways, I ended up in the following questions. Which one would I prefer if I knew I was going to be killed? To be killed by those speaking in a language I did not understand and be surrounded by the incomprehensible words, or by those speaking, albeit with minor difference, in my mother tongue or in a language I understood well? And were I lucky or unlucky enough to survive and brave enough to relate the horror I have witnessed, in which language would I do that? In the language of the lullabies I slept by as a child, or in one that I learned afterwards? 2, I already knew that translation was more or less an act of violence, especially in the case of Armeno-Turkish, because it was not a standard variety and I was smoothing out things while translating. But what was it exactly that I smoothed out? What was lost in my translation? What could a testimony in Armeno-Turkish offer us that others cannot? So these were the basic questions. To this aim, I first went through other Armeno-Turkish testimonies and then went back to the book I was editing. Here I skip my readings of other testimonies, but I'll show examples. Meyka adlı çocuğun tehcir anıları. This is an oral testimony. Cebeciyans bir Ermeni subayın Çanakkale ve Doğu Cephesi günlüğü. This is a manuscript on the 1895-96 massacres in pogroms in Kayseri, and this is one on 1915. Simon Arakelyan was a Catholic Armenian. He says Armenian Catholic throughout the text, by the way. Born and raised in Ankara, worked for the regime, was married with a daughter, had a sister and a maternal uncle, knew French and Armenian. This is what I can get from the text. Like Catholic Armenians in general and those of Ankara in specific, Turkish was his mother tongue and he wrote it using the Armenian letters. These are facts. The book was published in Istanbul in Beyoğlu in Simon Ohanyan Efendi's printing press. In the endnote, Arakelyan apologizes for the clumsiness of his writing and adds that he was consoled as it was historical and true to reality and he was not getting emotional while writing it. His first-person narrative temporarily belongs to what Mark Nishanyan calls the first wave of testimonies, written roughly between 1919 and 1924, mostly by literate survivors who had been deported from Istanbul and had managed to return. It was, for example, written and printed concurrently with Balakian's Armenian Golgotha, to name just one. Arakelyan calls his book a memoir, not only in the title, but also throughout the text. Here I have to skip the question, what is a memoir, what is a testimony, what is a diary? I just skip it. He begins with a short historical account on the First World War, Turkey's initial position, intentions of the Unionists, especially Enver Pasha, whom he holds clearly responsible for the catastrophe that followed. He then explains why he wrote the memoir. A, most of the people who could do this were killed. Death of the witness, Nishanyan. B, survivors for some reason have not written anything yet. Had he not read the already printed material? Apparently not, or he says so. C, he did not want the deportation to be forgotten. This is okay. The rest is an almost day-by-day account of the deportation of Catholic Armenians from Ankara, punctuated with some documents such as telegraphs asking for help, petitions to the government, as well as digressions to praise the efforts of the Pope to save Catholic Armenians, or to sketch a dream scene where the author discusses divine justice with an anonymous mother whose husband was brutally killed and children were lost. Ureir astvats, avelijist ures astvats. And the author is so angry with the spirits that he says, come to your senses, kendine gel, hayal misin, nesin, whoever you are, you can't say that. The climax is the great fire of Ankara in 1916. That's where the text stops. I should also note here that the book is not merely based on the author's observations. Arakelyan apparently did some research, interviewed other witnesses, some of whom were Muslims, followed the news about the trials, and put them all together. Despite his humbleness, which is traditional in a way, and the minor flaws throughout the text, Arakelyan is obviously a well-read man. He begins and ends his narrative with allusions to Sodom and Gomorrah, refers to Cain and Abel while explaining human violence, the nature of human violence, makes biblical quotations, knows contemporary politics well enough to interpret European politics in the wake of war, at least. As his employment requires, he must have had a very good command of Turkish and French. Indeed, the text attests to his knowledge of Ottoman Turkish, that is, the literary written language used by the educated and or bureaucratic elite. Unlike other known Armeno-Turkish testimonies and memoirs, the ones I showed you, the language used by Arakelyan contains sarcastic quotation marks, let's say, gavur. He puts it into brackets. They called us gavur, infidel. Puns. Instead of envali metruke, abandoned properties, he says envali mahsube, usurped properties. As opposed to other Armeno-Turkish testimonies, which are stripped of emotions, usually, Arakelyan's account is replete with asides, commentaries, lamentations, condemnations, acknowledgments, and ornamented with similes. Emotions such as sadness and hopelessness are so extensively expressed that at one point I had to admit that I did not know the exact differences between certain Turkish words used for them, like meyus became a nightmare for me. What exactly did meyus mean? Just being unhappy? Hopeless? However, it's not possible to say that he was only using the literary Ottoman Turkish. It was rather a hybrid, partially non-standard variety, and this is open to debate for reasons beyond me. We can talk about this. What could Arakelyan's testimony offer us? This is the conclusion. To begin with, his testimony is a very clear example of the possible amalgamation of discourses in a testimony. This is not observable in the juxtaposition of different perspectives and scales, like in a miniature, but also in the use of narrative tense. A good example is the part where Arakelyan depicts a crowd of women deportees he watched from the garden of a wealthy and benevolent Armenian who offered him and his companions shelter in Konya. This, for him, was the most dreadful scene of their journey up until that moment. What is striking in his narration is that, on the one hand, he seems to be far enough to write about tens of thousands of people desperately walking, and on the other, close enough to describe a woman giving birth and a child, ignorant of what is going on around him, putting his fingers in the mouth of his dead mother. This could only be possible if Arakelyan was merging in his narrative either scenes he witnessed in different times and or places, or his own experience with what he learned from other sources. The verbal manifestation of this merging in the text is the intermingling of tenses. In parts where personal testimony, rumors, news, and the outcome of an interview or interrogation intertwine, three narrative tenses intertwine, like dili geçmiş, mişli geçmiş, and geniş zaman, the past, simple past, the past perfect and simple present, they all get into each other. Second, the book brings boundaries into question, which is possible only in a non-standard variety of languages. The we and they can refer to many things throughout the text. We can mean I, that is Simon Arakelyan, Catholics, Armenians, deportees, human beings, whereas they can mean deportees, Muslims, Armenians, Lusavor Chaganer, Armenian women, etc. This can be observed in any text, it's okay. But what is interesting is that sometimes he begins a sentence in the third person plural pronoun and ends it with a second person plural verb, which is very interesting. So you see how the boundary between the witness and the victim disappears. And then there are the word choices. He says, menfilik hatıralarım, exile. He uses the word menfi. And then he calls the deportees muhacir. You know, in Turkish now, Ermeniler tehcire tabi tutuldu. They were deported, but they are not muhacir. They are not deportees. So muhacir is from Muslims from the Balkans or the Caucasus, which is very interesting in itself. Okay. The major question, however, is yet to be answered. Why write a testimony in Turkish? Was it because Turkish was his mother tongue, because he could express himself better? Then why did Bahram Altunyan, whose written Turkish was really poor, did the same? I showed you the cover. Was Altunyan trying to hide his agony from his family while he saved it from oblivion? Did writing in Turkish keep the witness in a safe distance from the emotional burden of remembering the catastrophe and supplied the best tool for a language stripped of emotions, like a message in a bottle? Did Arakelyan write in Turkish because he was a Catholic? And as Hratcha Acaryan argued, a Catholic Armenian would do anything to distance himself from Armenianness? For Belidian, it's a Protestant thing, by the way. Then why did non-Catholic Armenians wrote the Armeno-Turkish testimonies or memoirs I showed a while ago, despite the fact that they were not as well-versed in Turkish as him? Was it because to keep Armenian makur, masmakur, like I won't tell this in Armenian? Who was Arakelyan's intended audience? Armenians, Catholic Armenians, Turks? Then why did he use the Armenian letters? He obviously knew how to write in Arabic letters. If he wanted a larger audience, why didn't he write in French, which he could do, or in colloquial Turkish, in the vernacular, which was almost always preferred in Armeno-Turkish writings? Or was it simply because the language of violence he witnessed was Turkish? Examples and questions abound. I stop here. Thank you for your patience.